Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining me for tonight's edition of Williams Around the Way. My name is Tonya Richardson, and I am the Public Relations and Communications Officer for the City of Wilmington and for our Mayor, Dennis P. Williams. The Williams Around the Way program is designed to provide the mayor and members of his administration with opportunities to share news going on in the city, talk about programs, and to highlight individuals who are helping to make the city be a wonderful place to live, work, and play. Today, my guests are going to be three of the pivotal local partners in developing a unique employment, training, home rehabilitation, and home ownership program that is providing opportunities for Wilmingtonians to really engage in the economic development that's going on in the city and their own personal economic development. I'll also be speaking with a local mother who is taking it upon herself to gather her community to encourage not only those of us who have been impacted by hearing about gun violence across the city, but to inspire those who may find themselves close to or on the fringes of gun violence and violent activities, and inspire them to take steps and use resources to help them make better choices. I'd like to start this evening, though, by sharing a press release that was released this week by Chief Cummings and Mayor Williams. The two of them, through this press release, announced that homicide clearance rates and firearm felony arrests specifically have led to an increase in clearance rates. So to be clear, there's been a 37% increase in solving crimes that are both violent, that are felonies, or that resulted in a homicide. You may recall that the mayor created the police department's homicide unit just last year. Chief Cummings announced that 33.53% increase in felony arrests involving firearms is really tremendous compared to what we were dealing with this time last year. The chief attributes this activity resulting in solving more homicides and arresting violent offenders in clearances and arrests to aggressive policing strategies, building strong partnerships with the community and with other law enforcement agencies. And I'll talk about that in just a moment. Increased focus on police and community relations has led to this significant increase. And you'll hear that these community relationships are not just with citizens, although that is a major piece of it, but you're about to hear about how the police department is working with federal and local organizations that are really pitching in to support what they're doing. Today, 7 of the 19 homicides that have occurred this year have been closed with an arrest by the department's detectives and police officers. Mayor Williams emphasizes that public safety remains a pillar of his administration, and protecting citizens is the most important service that government provides. It's the administration's hope that this progress encourages residents who WPD must engage with to continue to help the police department do what it's doing. In addition to homicide arrests, the Wilmington Police Department has made 600 adult felony arrests and 125 juvenile felony arrests. The department has also made 215 arrests involving firearms compared to just 161 arrests made this time last year, and that's a significant increase. This represents a 34% increase in those numbers, and some of that can be attributed to the deployment of Operation Disrupt and, again, partnerships with other law enforcement agencies. The department's involvement with the Violence Reduction Network, often referred to as the VRN, has contributed to probably the most in this effort. Wilmington was among just 5 national cities selected to participate in an elite new federal network, which provides the department with access to experienced federal government offices and resources. The detective division are able to receive extensive training, and they meet often with these national partners and the cities that have also been selected in this VRN. Through the VRN, they're trained in homicide protocol, how to execute effective crime-solving strategies, and also case management, which is a big piece of ultimately getting to clearance. The executive officer of the Wilmington PD Criminal Investigative Division also holds regular meetings with the Attorney General's office, again, connecting at the state level, which has facilitated a more effective process in moving homicide cases to actual arrests. New strategies effectively solve crime, and one of those new strategies is Chief Cummings' desire to move forward in the implementation of Real-Time Crime Center, which is called RTCC for short. And that will be an initiative that happens within the public safety building here downtown. RTCC should assist not only in solving, but also deterring crime around the city, as police officers will have access to a camera system that monitors activity across the city, have the ability to track activity through license plate readers, and receive information reporting criminal offenses in real time. I think that it's important for us to continue to have a community conversation about violence, homicide, the job that the police are doing. And I want to invite all of our neighbors to continually engage with the police department and provide feedback. And when you can, provide the type of assistance that can lead to homicide clearance rates. It's most important to our community effort to solve the problem and to keep each other safe. We'll be right back, where I'll be talking to members of the City of Wilmington's Department of Real Estate and Housing, the Central Baptist Community Development Corporation, and Local 55, who are all our local primary partners in developing an employment training program that I think you'll be really impressed with. Look forward to seeing you in a few. Thanks.
That we try and make each other sad. Thunder, fairy star.
Thanks for staying with us. We're back with our first segment this hour of Williams Around the Way. As I mentioned, my second guest this afternoon are a group of individuals who have come together for the sake of doing some really amazing partnership that hits many notes for the Williams administration as well as for the city as a whole. These partners are part of putting together a residential construction training and employment program that is actually phase two of a program that started over a year ago. In this program, Wilmingtonians will be enrolled in a Department of Labor certified career training program where they will receive education, intensive mentorship, and hands-on training to become Department of Labor certified journeymen through Local Union 55. My guests on set today are, first, I'll go with you, Nialah, our lady on the panel. Nialah Gilliam, my colleague at the City of Wilmington. Nialah is the Director of Real Estate and Housing and has a long history with the department, over 20 years. She's very informed, not only about the community, but about real estate and housing. And that can be complicated sometimes, but she's really good at making it plain for us. So we look forward to hearing from you.
Thank you.
I also welcome Reverend Terrence Keeling here to my right. Reverend Keeling is the pastor of Central Baptist Church, which is located on East 9th Street in Wilmington. He's also the founder, president, and CEO of the Central Baptist Community Development Corporation and is a partner in the conglomeration of community organizations that make up both Eastside Rising and the Blueprint Community on the east side of Wilmington. Welcome. And thirdly, my new friend, John Blyden. John is the business agent and a lead organizer for Local Union 55, which is a construction union based in Newark, out of New Jersey. But it's also he's very key in the application of this program in the city. So welcome, John.
Out of Delaware,
I'm sorry.
Yes.
So Nialah, I'm going to start with you as my city colleague. Start us off by describing how the City of Wilmington came to be a part of this program.
Well, Tonya, I would say, and John, I think, was a part of this. It was probably early in 2014, when Mayor Williams he summoned several department heads, including myself. And I believe John was there also,
yes,
to his office to talk to us about the fact that there were too many unemployed and underemployed persons in the City of Wilmington. And he tasked us with coming up with a program that would put people to work and not just having jobs, not under the table $10 an hour jobs, but that there would be meaningful employment, sustainable employment. And he gave us a mandate to make it happen. This was early in 2014, as I said. And so we began to put our heads together to try to come up with how we could do this. And of course, with John Blyden, who, you know, in his involvement in the union, he was very key to the meetings that we had early on. At the beginning stages, my Department of Real Estate and Housing, and the Department of Licenses and Inspection at the time under then Commissioner Jeffrey Starkey, we were able to immediately working together with the Wilmington Housing Partnership to have some job opportunities that we made available that Local 55, they were the construction firms that work, one of the firms that works with Local 55 and employed the people in the first phase, which I'm sure Reverend Keeling will talk about.
Yeah.
We were able to put them to work on various jobs. One, that was the job down at the, was that 4th and, I want to say that's Orange or Shipley,
yep,
where the lighting, yes, building had mm-hmm, burnt down. And they did a beautiful job in building a new wall there. We were able to put them to work doing some renovations on projects. And so that was how the Department of Real Estate and Housing came to be involved in this project. We came back to the mayor probably around May of 2014 with what we were proposing to be done. And for, you know, various and sundry reasons, that particular program did not go forth. Hence, we kept working as we did as our individual departments. And, you know, when Reverend Keeling and John pick up, I can tell you how we have come to the point where they get together. We can tell you how we came to the point where we are today, which is a very exciting place.
Right. It's good for us to know that these partnerships, and we'll talk about the detail of this partnership, of course, in this conversation, but that the mayor knew that it couldn't just be the city that figured out how
Absolutely.
To create apprenticeship programs.
Absolutely.
Or how to make these types of things happen. Reverend Keeling, how did your organization, the Central Baptist Community Development Corporation, come to the table? And what were your early orientations to this project?
Well, for us, it started really maybe far back as 5 years ago, when Eastside Blueprint was putting together a plan to revitalize Eastside community. And as we were putting together that plan, we realized that we were going to need a 501c3 that we could work through and with in order to implement the plan. It is a community-based plan that we insisted would be implemented by the community. And so part of that plan, it really was a three-pronged, so to speak, plan based on housing, refurbishment, workforce development, and economic empowerment. One of the things that we were charged to do in that, to implement that plan, was put together a workforce development program where we could recruit local people that were going to work on those houses and then ultimately be able to come and buy those homes. And so we started down the road trying to put together the workforce development with the soft skills and hard skills, but we realized real quickly that we didn't have capacity. So we set up in our minds that we would build capacity through collaboration, and came across John and realized, hey, I don't have to reinvent the wheel. This guy knows how to train people in construction. So that was the beginning of our relationship and how we came on board with that.
Wonderful. So then that leads us to John and Local 55. Tell us how Local 55 came to the initiative and why Wilmington?
Okay, well, thank you, Tonya, for having me on the show. Thank the mayor. Well, Local 55 is a newly formed residential local. We started about 7 years ago, right before the housing crash. Talk about timing, right? And this local was built to basically organize workers that's in the residential field, workers and contractors. So I was actually put on the ground here in Wilmington 6 years ago, not in Wilmington, in Delaware, to establish this local. Now, why Wilmington? Three reasons. First, it was really personal to me because 22 years ago, I used to live on the east side, and I was always dreaming about an opportunity. And I was very lucky at the time to be able to join Local 199 and start my trajectory towards a career. And because of that opportunity, I think it saved my life, and it provided opportunity for my kids to go to college. And when I often talk about things I used to do to my kids, they don't believe it. They say, Dad, you're square. But but for me, it was the right thing to do. It's sort of going back to the place that I started. And I knew that I wasn't special, that if folks had an opportunity, a real opportunity for a career, they'd jump at it. So Wilmington was very special to me, especially where I used to live. The second reason why Wilmington? I remember sitting at the table at Evelyn's, and I was talking to a group of workers and contractors, and Mayor Williams, at the time he was Representative Williams, he came over to the table and he said, John, I'm going to help you put these young men to work. And shortly after that, he became the mayor. And we met, and I didn't help him. I wasn't part of his campaign, but we met, and what Mayor Williams said to me, he said, John, I'm tired of seeing Jersey and Philly contractors coming here, doing all the work, and our folks are just on the sideline watching. He said, we're going to do something to change that. So for me, when you have a mayor that's committed to these kind of partnerships, rolling up his sleeve to make things like this happen, it's almost a no-brainer. The third reason why was when I met Pastor Keeling. I met a man of faith that was as committed, not just in talks, but as in deeds, to make this thing happen. So for 55 and for our labor union, it's an opportunity for minorities to join the labor ranks and to work hand in hand with the community. And I actually feel as though that we're creating here a national model.
Wonderful. As we've discussed this in the past several, probably about a year or so since I first met the three of you and started learning about the work you do, it's really inspiring, and I think I really want to hit that the note that this is a partnership where any of the three of you having the idea to do something like this may have led to something different. But the fact that the city, a local CDC, and a local union that can actually train people somehow came together through this administration, and now there are people who have applied, been accepted, mm-hmm. gone through preliminary training where they've learned these soft skills, as mm-hmm. you have spoken to, everything mm-hmm. from professionalism to mm-hmm. How to handle yourself on the job, conflict resolution, and that as recently as this week, they started going to training where they'll have a national certification. Mm-hmm. How is that different from the original program? The pilot last year that you spoke to, Reverend Keeling, was really yeah. just kind of the spark that led to this. How is this different?
Yes, I'll tell you, Johnson, I'm a man of faith. I do believe that we're at a particular time and place with, you know, God is working. We preach a gospel that says that through Jesus Christ, the power of God has been made available to bring about a change in people's lives, and that we're to be used to make that happen. So we entered into this thing believing that change could take place, that it needed to happen, and that if we applied ourselves, that change would happen. So it's just a natural that we would come to here.
So let's get to the nitty gritty. mm-hmm. Let's talk numbers. How many Wilmingtonians are currently enrolled in this program? What have they done to become eligible? Mm-hmm. What was the recruiting process? And what are they getting in terms of hours in the classroom, training, mentorship? Mm-hmm. Talk to me about the program itself.
The original program was set up, as you may or may not know, as part of Eastside Rise. And when I talked about that component, that was that second leg that we talked about mm-hmm. of Eastside Rise. And so we had an agreement with a group of developers that they were going to revitalize 135 homes and that we were going to train the people to work on those homes. The first phase was we actually went out. Our job was to recruit. And then to train, and then to get them on the job. So that first phase that you talked about were the first people that we went out. We held a job fair in conjunction with Union 55, and we vetted the people, and we found a group of people that we thought could really represent the East Side, and it would be a good starting point. John, I tell you, because we took them through. And it didn't take us long to realize that, you know, we needed another phase. We needed that soft skills piece.
Yes, yes.
But, you know, some of them were extremely professional. Now just let me back up a little, because it's important that everyone understands that behind our end of it was a group of volunteers from the community that were committed to these individuals. And they will tell you, about some of the older women that were like grandmothers, that were like, hey, what are you in their face if they went off track? So it has been a community effort, and they knew from the beginning that the community was not only behind them, but was going to hold them accountable.
Wonderful.
And so we sent them off to John, and, you know, I often say that there is no manual for something like this.
Yeah.
We're writing this as we go along.
Yes, we are.
And it was some tough times. It was some give or take, but it was a coming to understand how to work together mm-hmm. in order to reach a goal, which was really to not just revitalize the community, but to build a community.
Great. So how many Wilmingtonians have started this
from
phase?
The first phase?
No, this week.
How many are working
toward journeyman status
okay.
beginning right now?
Well, let me kind of go back to our criteria. In order to actually join the apprenticeship program, You had to be 18 years or older, pass a drug test, and physically able to do the work. So after our recruitment, we found 17 individuals that was able to do the work, 18 years or older, went through the soft skills, but when it got down to the actual drug testing phase, we only had 9 that was able to move forward.
Okay.
Which is, to me, a very good number, because when you start an apprenticeship program, these young men and women have to get their working hours. So that's a very manageable group. And as we get this group moving forward in the program, it will actually show the community that this is actually working. And then we can encourage the next group.
So to clarify, being a member of this cohort of apprentices mm-hmm. guarantees you hours that you're going to work.
Through our contract,
this is
yes.
not a program where you get a training and then you may or may not have
no.
something to do. This is a program, because it's certified by the Department of Labor,
yes.
we know there's work on the back end mm-hmm. for them to do. And that makes it very different from other apprenticeship programs.
Well, that's why this partnership with the city is important, because anybody can just train folks, but it's the placement piece. So if we don't have the jobs in the pipeline, we surely doesn't make sense to fill people heads up with hope and they're not going out to the job.
Excellent.
So the partnership with Nialah, the city, actually will create the workload for this group.
And so Nialah, how does the city fit into this part of the logistics? So we've recruited people, the program's been built on a pilot that was really successful, we've moved it to the next level, and now it's a Department of Labor certified program. How does the city fit into guaranteeing that there'll be work?
Well, one of the functions of my department is property management. We, Department of Real Estate and Housing, manages the city-owned properties. About a year and a half ago, I probably because, you know, divine providence knew that this was going to come about, signed up for a Wells Fargo program, REO program, which is actually foreclosed properties that the bank now owns. And at the time, because they've changed the model now, but at the time they would send me emails and they'd say, are you interested in XYZ property? I would send my staff member out to check on the condition of the property, and if we thought we could do something with it, we accepted it. Over about the last year and a half, we had accepted about 11 such properties, 11 to 12 properties. And we were putting them aside to do a special program. We were trying to figure out what we're going to do, another homestead program like the city had done over, well, I guess maybe 30 years ago. We were going to do something with the mayor's blessing. We're going to do something spectacular with those units. Well, in June of this year, I had the opportunity to attend an event where the partnership between Central Baptist CDC and another partner, NCRC, was laid out. Very good program, and I was able to see that where we were concerned in the past about capacity, we now saw that they had another partner who not only was bringing more capacity, but also was bringing finances to the table for construction. And because I was at that event, and I knew what Reverend Killing was trying to do and wanted to get properties from the city, it was sort of like a voila, those properties that we had put aside for this special program. I said, we could actually donate those properties to Central Baptist CDC, who's now partnering with this other partner who's bringing another piece, including finances, to the table. And this is going to be a win-win, not only for Central Baptist CDC and Eastside Rising, but also for the city of Wilmington, who really needed to have an apprenticeship program and has never had one. Because we receive federal funds, CDBG to be exact, jurisdictions really should have some connection with an apprenticeship program that provides training, not just in construction, but broad. But construction is probably where my department comes in, because real estate and housing, of course, we do housing. So it made sense to partner with Reverend Keeling and Local 55 for the initiative that I heard laid out now, that was more expansive, that had the missing piece, which was finances involved. And so we put our heads together, and we are where we are today. We were able to give them a list of those properties. Their representative was able to look at the properties, because they wanted to make sure that we weren't giving them, you know, properties that were so dilapidated mm-hmm. that it would be cost prohibitive to renovate them. So they were able to select the properties not only from the list that came from Wells Fargo, but we gave them our expanded list of properties and allowed them to select the properties that they would like to work with. And so that brings us to where we are today.
That the information that you bring to this is kind of where the rubber meets the road.
Mm-hmm.
To have units where people will be able to purchase these units. These are homes that right now are empty
mm-hmm.
For a variety of reasons, and they're being put back in the stock of homes that the city can make available to Wilmingtonians. And that really brings me to the next part of the partnership.
And Mike might want to add affordable. I guess that's the key word for us when it comes to housing development, affordable housing. And so that's one of the things that we know and we guarantee that's going to happen with this partnership, that those houses, more than likely, as Reverend Keeling said, some of the very men and women who will be working on those houses, training and actually working as apprentices, will be able to then purchase a house.
Let's talk about that. One of the partners in this very intricate partnership is the NCRC, which is the National
Community
Reinvestment Corporation, which
yeah.
is a federal, nationwide organization that's also providing supports to this mm-hmm. endeavor. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little about that.
Well, NCRC is, as you said, a national organization that really focuses on community reinvestment, trying to get corporations, banks, so on and so forth, to invest in communities. And we happen to come across, as I said, I do believe everything happens for a reason at a time, and that there is some divine providence involved, as Nialah said. We happened across them at a meeting at the Department of Labor, and it turns out that what our objectives were very similar to a national model they had. The same thing as revitalizing homes, the same thing as workforce development, the same thing as getting people who worked on those homes to be able to own the homes. And in our conversations, we saw a place where we could have common ground and they could help us with capacity. As I said, we were an emergent CDC, and we had these great ideas. We had people in the community we felt could get some things accomplished. But we did realize that in order for us to do things, we would have to build some collaborations. And they came on, they helped us where we were really trying to emphasize workforce development and putting that soft skills together. They gave us soft skills capacity, which took us to the next level. And by partnering with them, it also helps us do the other objectives, which is to take those people who are working on the homes, get them to the point where they are financially secure, able to get a mortgage, and then get those homes that they're working on. Really build not only capacity, but financial independence.
John?
Something I want to add, even though we're talking about this nine and apprentice, you see, apprentices have to go in the field with actual journey folks. So through this partnership with NCRC and the work that's happening on the ground now, we've been able to put 40 people to work. So we're able to put 40 journeymen that may have been unemployed in the community, mm-hmm. they're actually earning paychecks. And actually, some of the folks from the first group may be the first ones in line to get one of those houses.
That's commendable.
Yeah.
I think that one thing that community organizations, municipalities, federal governments
mm-hmm.
all struggle to do is to create that line,
mm-hmm.
that continuity that really can take a person from the personal development
mm-hmm.
to the skills development,
mm-hmm.
the placement,
mm-hmm.
the having continual work,
mm-hmm.
and then having the supports to get to a place
mm-hmm.
to live the life they want to live, and homeownership
mm-hmm.
is a part of that. So I hope that we're conveying well that this partnership really touches all of the key needs, which ultimately on one end of the spectrum speak to what's going on for the city
mm-hmm.
and what this means on a large scale, but then also what it's going to mean on the small scale for individuals,
mm-hmm.
Families.
Mm-hmm.
Nialah?
I just wanted to add, though Central Baptist CDC is located on the east side, with this particular program, the units or the houses that we're donating to them are in various parts of the city. They're on the north side, I think we have east side, probably west. We probably have them all over the city. So, you know, even though they are located on the east side, there will be houses available in several areas of the city once they are renovated by this program.
And the program is not just, you know, for people on the east side. Of course, we want people on the east side to get employment. But it is citywide. I mean, it's a citywide program, ultimately to increase home ownership, increase the financial position of people in the city of Wilmington. So.
And John, could you list for us and describe the types of actual specifications and skills that participants will learn as a part of their journeyman certificate? I know. My understanding is that there have been programs that have been focused on like the demolition side.
Yes,
we're going beyond just demolition.
Yes,
here.
This is major league here, because we are talking about careers, and a worker may need to be a jack of all trade in order to support his family. So this set of apprentices will have the option to take part of different training tracks. We have a training track in green construction, which can go anywhere from solar panel installation to weatherization, infrared reading. We have deconstruction, which is demolition, but knowing how to remove asbestos if it's found, lead, and bringing down the structure in a safe manner. So that's our deconstruction track. Then you have a track called green landscaping, which has everything to do with lawns and pruning and that whole aspect. And then you have the part that's really active, and that's the sustainable building, which goes anywhere from windows, doors, drywall, framing, painting, masonry. So the one thing about this is we have over 70 different training tracks. So you may have an individual that might be good with brick and block, but may not be good in carpentry. So we really find a niche where someone would be able then to go out and earn. Let me see, something else I wanted to add, but that's basically it.
And through Local 55, their membership with the local, does that also qualify them for ongoing training and continued career development?
Good question. We are not funded by grants or anything else. We are a self-funded organization. So once someone is a member, which is $192, they're a member for a year, and they have to keep up their book after that, which is $16 a month. You are welcome to take any construction training that's offered at the training center. How we kind of generate this self-sustainability is through our contractors. Our contractors basically put back into the pot once individuals are working. And I don't want to not mention the contractors, because contractors that partner with 55 play a real critical role to this movement. Because it's one thing for someone to learn something in a training environment, in a control environment, but that contractor have to have the patience to let that individual actually do what he learned or she learned in the field. And we have a committed group of contractors that we work with. And I mean, there was one gentleman from the first group that he had to put in and take out probably 20 windows. But now he's the window expert. He can do historical windows. So that's the kind of commitment we look for in our contractors.
Wonderful. Well, you know, as we wrap up this segment, I want to give each of you an opportunity. If there's anything that I've missed, if there's some nuance or some value that you'd like to share with our neighbors here across the city about this partnership, I want to give you the opportunity to do that.
Well, for me, I think we've really getting into the construction aspect of our training program, but our training program really is comprehensive and growing. We realize that not everyone wants to be in construction. So we do offer different training. We build capacity, as I said, through partnerships. You can come in our training program, and by going through us, you can enter into a CNA program. We'll be offering malware, Microsoft Office, copper cable networking. So we really are striving to be diverse and to make sure not only that we train the people, but then that we place them. We do have an employment agency that we've started, really trying to think of all the ways that we can maximize the opportunities for people.
Wonderful. Nialah?
I just wanted to reiterate the fact that if it were not, from my standpoint, for Mayor Williams' insistence that people in the city of Wilmington be gainfully employed, and at the time, like I said, he didn't care, you know, if they had a record, but if they're on the straight and narrow now, he wanted them employed. And so I just need to stress the fact that it was his insistence, and he was really, really adamant. And he, you know, he kind of nailed our feet to, or held our feet to the fire with this. And I'm really grateful of his commitment, because had it not been for his commitment, I'm pretty sure that we would not be at the point that we are now. So I'm really grateful, as you know, one of his department heads, that I had the opportunity to participate and to help fulfill a commitment that he had made to John, you know, even before he was elected.
Great. John.
Well, you stole my thunder with that. But what I will like to add is that even though we're here, by no means I want to give the, I don't want to give the example of that this is easy. This is not easy work. It didn't happen overnight. Pastor Keely and Nialah, we've been working at this for four years. And there's been times when we don't agree with the approach, but because we had the same values, we stayed at the table. And I don't want to leave here with folks thinking that we spiked the football and scored the touchdown, but we're still gaining yards. And I hope in the future that we can put more people to work, because we all believe that Wilmingtonians should work where they live.
Awesome. I want to thank you, Reverend Keeling, Director Nialah Gilliam, and Union Representative, Local 55 Representative John Blyden, for being here today. It's really been my privilege not only to learn about this in my role with the mayor, but to think about ways that any Wilmingtonian who has an idea, who thinks they can be a part of change on any level, this is an example of what can happen when you share your vision, when your heart is in the right place, and you take the steps to reach out to people who have access to resources. Really amazing things will come from this. I look forward to possibly in the spring bringing some participants from the program and hearing how it's going, and possibly doing some success stories. Thanks again.
Thank you.
After a short break, I'll introduce you to Michelina DeJesus of 302 Guns Down. Ms. DeJesus is a Wilmington mother with a passion, a drive, and a talent, you'll see, for bringing community members together for the sake of doing necessary work in the city. Please stay with us.
Why we treat each other.
Welcome back, and thanks for staying with us for this final segment of Williams Around the Way. Right now, I'd like to introduce you to Michaelina DeJesus, who goes by Mikey.
Mikey, yes.
Mikey is a Wilmingtonian, a young mother, who, like most of us, has been watching the news, lives in the community, and has been affected by gun violence going on across the city. And she has taken a unique step just as an individual to try to make a difference. Mm-hmm. Why don't you tell us about what you're working on?
This event is called 302 Guns Down. It's going to be held September 20th, this Sunday, at Judy Johnson Park from 12 to 5. What this event is not just a rally for gun awareness, but more importantly, to have as many resources and opportunities available for our young adults and teens. A lot of the crime has come from, you know, around 16 to 25, I'm not going to limit it, but a lot of it. So we want to create as many opportunities for after school, things to get involved in. You know, if we can just motivate more to gear towards a more positive result instead of resulting to gun violence.
Right. Mm-hmm. How will this event be different from other rallies? There are lots of really dedicated, effective mm-hmm. Wilmingtonians who are engaged in movements that are each playing their part. How is your event going to be a little different?
Honestly, I think mine's going to be a little different because of the unity. I'm reaching out to all different areas of Wilmington. Also, reaching people from the hip hop nation, reaching out to alternative schools where really it's not just, hey, you know, let's all come together and do this. We're really, you know, grabbing people's hands where we think need to be involved in something like this. And just hoping to go forward. This is not just an event, it's a movement. So 302 Guns Down doesn't stop here. This is just our first annual. But we hope to really grab a hold of, you know, our young teens and young adults and try to reroute some views.
So to share with watchers mm-hmm. this afternoon, the event that will happen at Judy Johnson Park will happen from 12 to 5.
Right.
It's free.
Free, yes. Bring your kids. There's moon bounces, face painting, family friendly, everyone. We ask that... a lot of people are going to be wearing their rest in peace shirts, people that have lost people. We want to definitely get the message across and have that impact and really show the community how many people we've lost, like how many people are affected by this. And just supporters and community that are so every day there's a shooting, you know, so if we can all come together each day, you know, each one teach one each day. If we grab a hold of one, I'm pretty sure slowly but surely we'll make a difference.
I have mentioned in passing this hour that you are doing this on your own as an individual. You're not a nonprofit. You're not attached to a church group, but you have managed to bring together 30 some partners that yes. will basically comprise of a resource and job fair at this event.
Exactly.
So that in addition to coming to show support for victims' families and to support people who want to make better choices, mm-hmm. you're actually going to provide resources. Tell us about some of the partners who will be there accepting applications and giving information.
Well, first I want to say, yes, this was an idea of mine, but there's so many people that come together that it's not just me. You know, one person knows the next, and before you know it, we have a whole event going on with it. You know, we have Target coming out, performance staffing, integrity staffing, Comcast, we'll have, let's see, I have some here, National Guards, Harris School of Business, Dawn's, American Beauty Academy, there'll be 10 barbers out there to cut free hair. Underground Comics, Street Expressions, they teach breakdancing, and they also promote to enroll in School of Arts. You know, that's another alternative. Brandywine, Anger Management, Westside, I mean, there's so many people, and every day we're building more. If somebody thinks that they have something to add towards it, you know, gearing in, you know, if we're all gearing in the same direction, whether it's anger management, whether it's a self-defense gym, something to do to create more things to do after school.
Awesome.
You know.
Well, I can't commend you enough for the energy you're putting in this. The mayor wholeheartedly supports what you're doing. The city is putting resources to help you have a successful event. We want to encourage all of our neighbors who are interested in supporting this movement to join them. That's next Sunday, the 20th, in Judy Johnson Park, which is at 2nd and Clayton, between 12 p.m. and 5 p.m., free event. And thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
Before we close today, I just want to remind viewers that everyone can find out information, like you see, every 2 weeks here on the show by going to the city's website, wilmingtonde.gov. If you'd like to receive emails about personal interest stories, information, press releases, changes in trash schedules, snow closures, just go to the bottom of the homepage, click the little envelope, and you'll be prompted to give us your email, and you'll stay up to date on events coming out of the mayor's office. I want to just mention also that if you are a small business owner and looking to build your entrepreneurship, to also call our Department of Economic Development, where they are launching their small business entrepreneurship series. They're taking applications through September 30th, and there's a nominal fee for absolutely amazing opportunities to build your business from the ground up as an entrepreneur. Just call Economic Development at 302-576-2120. My name's Tonya Richardson. I'm with the Mayor's Office of Communications. Thanks for joining us this hour on Williams Around the Way. Have a great evening and be well.